broadcast live.
For this installment of Catching Waves, we have partnered with Hennessy to have conversations with amazing creatives breaking boundaries. We will chat to Bobo, he's a stylist. Young Stilo, he's a photographer. Denise Mars, she's a DJ. And Faith 47, the visual artist. Hennessy, very special, has collaborated with South African-born street-turned-studio artist Faith 47. The first South African artist, also the first female voice to join the Hennessy very special limited edition series. Halala Sisi, a formidable artistic lineage that has featured internationally acclaimed talents such as Felipe Pantone, Bills, John Wan, Shepherd Fairey, Os Gemeos, Futura, and Kors. A self-taught talent, Faith 47 developed her artistic signature independently, building her vision as she grew up in South Africa. Early on, she became a rare breakout artist in the male-dominated graffiti scene. After first gaining notice under the tag Faith 47, her signature evolved to become Faith XLVII, which are the Roman numerals for 47. Faith 47 has created a powerful work of art representing Hennessy through the elements, earth, and the cycles of nature. With the sun and time as central elements, intricate detail pays tribute to nature via references to the moon, rain, clouds, and grapevines accentuated in previous gold leaf.
What up, Faith 47, or should I call you Liberty Do?
You can call me either. Faith is good. Let's do that.
Yeah, so when did Liberty Do come about? I love it, by the way.
That's actually just my name. And I've been using Faith as an alias my whole life. And I guess that came from just the graffiti culture where you have a moniker, like a name that you come up with, and it becomes like a different personality of yours, I guess. But I do think that we all have different personalities and we should have different names for them. You know, we're not like one character. We're multidimensional, so it works.
Faith 47, and the 47 is because of your grandmother's numerological theorem. Can you tell that? Us about that?
She told me once that many of the things in her life that came up added up into this number 47. So it was like a lucky number to her. And I was really close with her. So when she passed, and, you know, I was coming up with a name. And in the graffiti culture back then, like everyone had a name, or it was like Volko Star, or like, you know, Taki 183. So I wanted to just pay homage and kind of keep her with me in a sense. So that's where that came from.
Let's see it in Roman numerals. I couldn't go there. But then you had it written out properly as 47.
Yeah, I like the Roman numerals because I feel like it's nice to have something that's a bit mysterious and hidden. Yes. And if you really want to know, you can like find out and like that, right? We don't have that, right? We don't have to always make everything obvious. So that's what I like about the Roman numerals.
Talking about the graffiti background that you're from. You know, I lived in Cape Town from 2004 to 2005, but I also was there previously just for work reasons. And I would ride around like this Faith, this nice handwritten Faith. Were graffiti, but were more like art, but they were on the street. It was my first time seeing something like that. Uh-huh. And when they told me that, yo, this Hennessy campaign, you're going to be working with Faith, I didn't think it was going to be you, but it is you.
Yeah, so that's really cool that you got to see some of that early stuff, because Cape Town was like my stomping ground, you know, and we had a lot of fun out there. But Johannesburg too, I had some great times in Johannesburg with Rusty and some of the guys out there. Yeah, I definitely feel like I grew up in public in a lot of ways. Like, you know, I was schooled through like this very kind of unconventional art form of graffiti and moving into like muralism and that. And then, you know, like evolving over time into more like contemporary work and that. But I'm so grateful for that. It really gave me such a deep experience of the country I was living in and, yeah, the different communities and areas and, yeah.
When we talk about the transition from graffiti, street art to modern contemporary art, When did you make that transition? What made you make that transition?
You know, like in life, it's an evolution. I think one thing leads to another. I was painting primarily public works, like, and I love that. And I still will always do that because I love the engagement of just the everyday person on the street. And I love the way that you can like really engage with like the textures and the space, and you have an effect on a community. And you know, you're having a conversation with a real life space. So for me, that's really powerful. But I also really like the intimacy of the studio and the kind of conversations you can have in those spaces. So I think as my work kind of evolved and the things I wanted to say needed to take on different forms, I was really open to learning a lot of different mediums. And I've always felt like when you learn a different medium, it allows you to kind of have a different vocabulary. And like a language, you know? So, right. Yeah, there's limits within like working in the public too. And I feel like for me, like working in sculpture or video, like really just gives me a different form of discovering what I want to say, how I can say it. I think that's probably what it is. And maybe just a little bit more fine tuned in some areas and that as well. Yeah.
Awesome. Let's get to the brand part about it with Hennessy. You know, years back, I think 5 years ago, they had Shepherd Fairy here in Johannesburg. And I was there for that event and they had the Obey box. And I kept it. Obviously, I kept it. Fast forward to 2020. And I get this opportunity to work on this campaign with you. And I'm like, wow, you know, it's so crazy. And I know you are a fan of spiritual things and alignment. So I know that you get what I'm saying right now, how just for me, it's just incredible, something going this full circle, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I was also at the Obey launch in Johannesburg. So we were in the same room, I'm sure.
Imagine.
Yeah, I was there. When they approached me, I was like, yeah, definitely, let's do this, you know? Also because they've only had men until now. So I was like, well, we need to open the space up, don't we?
That's what I was going to ask you next. What an honor it is to be the first female. How do you feel about that? Speak on that. You're blazing a trail, Faithy.
I'm definitely a feminist. And coming from South Africa, I think we're all aware of like the gender-based violence issues. And, you know, it's there's a lot of work to be done. Let's put it that way. And so for me, I had like a few female mentors growing up. And I'd say not even people I knew, but like Patti Smith, for instance, you know, like just strong female characters. And I think it's important to try to realize your own potential so that you can inspire others to do the same and also kind of open some of these spaces so that people see that they're available and that they can do it. And so, yeah, I feel like in some sense, I would like to mentor or be part of that, you know, like a kind of just the equaling of some of the scales, you know, in all avenues of life, be it racial, gender, whatever. I'm a firm believer in equality.
Your work talks about all the good things in life, you know? I really, really love that. It's about the environment. It's about spirituality. It's about humanity. It's about oneness with self. You talk about such outer worldly experiences and you bring it back to us in this three-dimensional space. What drove you in that direction?
You know, growing up in South Africa, I had a you have a sense that things are kind of wrong, you know, like I was still a kid during the apartheid era. Like, so you just had the sense that things were off. And yeah. My mother's very like aligned. She's like a healer. So I had this kind of just a sense of the kind of injustice of the world. And, I still feel that. I mean, the world is really hectic. It's really hectic. There's a lot of bad stuff happening. And I think that we've disconnected ourselves from the natural systems of nature. We see ourselves as separate from nature. And there's so many like catastrophes that are coming from that, you know, ecological and spiritual. We're disconnected from like our communities. And So yeah, I see it all as part of each other. You know, it's all connected. All of those like thematics that I work with, it's not like they're separate, but it's one big conversation. And it's, yeah, I think just something about like finding our humanity and then not having profit over people all the time, you know, like putting people and animals and nature first and then building like real societies that care. I think we need to go back to that because we've gone way off course, you know. It's very evident.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And big up to Hennessy for being such a powerful brand, and also because most powerful brands shy away of associating themselves with people with that have something to say. You know what I mean? So for them to go, yo, our corporate identity is not just a corporate identity. It's a corporate identity that also is wanting to deal with humanitarian issues. So let's align ourselves to someone who's got something to say personally and also something to say with their work.
Right. And I think, I think what they've done with all the artists from what I've seen is that they've given them just like a lot of freedom to just be themselves and create the work that is natural for them. So, for me, when I kind of saw their process of this kind of like very age-old system of how they make the Hennessy, which hasn't changed in like hundreds of years, and they're using like handcrafted barrels, and it's a very timely process. I just automatically kind of synced that with my own understanding of like alchemy and like taking base metals and transforming them into gold. And like, you know, that's also for me been something I've worked with in my work as well. The idea when you're taking your inspirations and concepts and like aggravations, and you're like putting them all together, and then you're creating art. And so I found like a thread there to work with. It was pretty seamless. And I agree, it is nice when you can have a collaboration with a brand and they actually are open. And I think we need more of that because the world is quite brand dominated these days. And, yes. You know, in the old days, artists were supported by the churches. That's where a lot of the, you know, the commissions came from, like religious places. Like if you look at like traditional like art. And now a lot of support does come from brands. And so we have to find a way to, you know, keep one's integrity.
Yes. And I love the fact that you mentioned the fact that the olden day artists were supported by churches, because a lot of people seem to think as an artist, you got to struggle, not, you know, have financial means, but they think it's a new thing for artists to be getting remunerated. But I love that you brought it way back.
I guess there's been such a long lineage of art history, and a lot of it has been like the suffering artist too.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think you've got to have your heart in the right place, and you've got to know why you're making work and what you're making and have good reasons for it. And that's the main thing. Whether or not you're successful, I think what is your definition of success? It should be, are you being kind of true to your own ethos? And if you are, then that's great. Nobody can really do anything, like, you know, say anything bad about that.
Talk to us about the actual design and artwork on the box.
I was inspired by the kind of process of the making of Hennessy, which for me resonated with a kind of alchemical process. It involves a lot of time and kind of respect of nature's cycles, the seasons, the temperature of that year, and what that does. So I was looking at old manuscripts of time cycles, earth and moon planetary systems, and those kind of old esoteric drawings, you know, and that was really the root, with the sun as the center force, and then everything moving around that cyclical movement. Awesome. And I also felt just like aesthetically having a center point in the whole design would work well in terms of a label, you know. So there's some practicality involved as well. And then the colors were inspired by the kind of rich tones of the Hennessy too.
I was reading your biography, and it's very seldom sometimes artists can be able to voice what they're doing. Sometimes artists feel like they talk enough with the work that they don't have to like talk and explain themselves or whatever. But there are a few quotes that I loved from reading your biography. Okay, I'll start with the first one. I am not religious, but I pray through my work to unknown devils and gods. I look for my soul in colors and empty my being through parables of rusted, lost metal doors. Oh, oh my goodness. Oh, 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 I'm losing my mind just reading it. I'm being lifted up to another place. It's almost as if I finished a whole bottle of Hennessy.
You make it sound so beautiful. Wow.
It is. So it already says everything there. But just to hear you explain it, let's open up the
floor. Hey, man. I don't know. I love writing. Hey, I've always written. So ever since I was young, I would just kind of free association writing. I would just sit and write and see what comes up. And I still do it every day, you know, when I wake up. And I have moments of inspirations where I think writing is so beautiful, and language, because it is like art. It's also just a form of communication. And sometimes you need to break it, you know, you have to find like ways to lead someone to something that you want to say, but you can't say it because words are limited. Yeah. So there's such beauty in that. So, yeah, I mean, I guess, I think I have fun on Instagram with that too, because for me, it's just like a way of playing with words. Yeah.
So I've seen that. You do it with your captions.
Yeah. I mean, I just see it as a tool. At the end of the day, it just needs to be, you have to make sure you're using it and it's not using you, you know, energetically. And then it's just another like form of communication.
There's something that says, she also has mentioned in an interview her process of urban exploration in which she feels spirits in empty buildings that felt like spiritual experiences, exploring holy chambers of neglected architecture, finding something so beautiful in what society disregards and bringing life to that which usually people throw away or ignore. Have you got a book out?
Yeah.
Besides the one that is your work.
A book of writing, maybe one day. On a serious note, that is very true. And it really began in Johannesburg, because I would come up to Joburg quite often. And, you know, I had one or two friends who were doing a lot of urban exploring there in the city. And as you know, like the buildings in Johannesburg are just really... I mean, it's just phenomenal what's going on down there and what has happened in that city, you know. And we would go in, one of my friends, Roy Potterall, he's a photographer, and we would go in and explore some of these buildings and like have the most incredible experiences in there. And sometimes paint, not always, but, you know, there would always be like people would have lived in those buildings and have been evicted. And so there would be writing on the walls, and you could see like the marks of people who had been there before. And there was kind of like a sadness to it too. How the buildings have been scrapped of all the metal, and it's just these huge relics, you know? And so when I started traveling internationally too, I guess a lot of the artists that I'm friends with do this kind of urban exploring too. So like if I was in Italy, then my friend there would take me to some like old ruins. And even in Moscow, I was in Moscow like a year or two ago, and I just hit up this woman on Instagram that I've been following for years, and she goes to like these abandoned churches in Russia. And we got up at 3 a.m. and we went for like a full day, just like going to look at all the old derelict kind of beautiful old churches there. So for me, it's just really a way of seeing a landscape of a place.
Just before we close, what do you wish this does? What do you wish this collaboration with Hennessy does for you and the people that support you and the people that don't even know you yet?
You know, I want to be selective about my collaborations that I do, and I want them to have quality, and I want them to be associated with people or brands or you know, institutions that I think I kind of align with. And so that worked. And I'm quite picky about who I collaborate with. And I mean, collaboration is actually really important to me. And I have a few artist friends that I collaborate with. And it's always something where, for me, it's got to be something where you're both benefiting from. It's like altruistic for both people, like, or both people involved. And I feel like in this case that did happen. Like, I feel like we both bringing something to the table. And yeah, it's a conversation.
Why move to LA?
That's a good answer.
That's a beautiful answer. Why move to LA?
Well, I moved to LA for 3 years, but I actually left LA when COVID hit. Everything kind of just, you know, I was on my way back to South Africa and landed up staying out here. Yeah, everything kind of went a bit crazy. And wow. So now I'm officially nomadic.
Where are you now?
I am in California right now. But my son and I have been kind of moving around month to month and just exploring some nature spaces. I felt like I needed to get out of the city into mm-hmm. nature.
I feel you.
But I mean, you know, like South Africa is always my home, and it will always be. And my mother and my friends, everyone's there. And I'm there like probably like 2 or 3 times a year if I can, like, except this year was tricky. But I'm not quite sure where I'll land up, and I'm maybe Portugal or something, you know, like I feel like Mediterranean, like close to, like, I'm still figuring it out, put it that way. And I have a bit of a nomadic life just due to what happened in my life, you know, through my career and that. And it really opened me up to being quite flexible.
How do you feel about your son being an artist themselves?
And that was just natural because we had Kia very young. We were like basically teenagers. And, you know, his father is an artist too. And he just grew up with that around him, with artists around him, photographers, creative people. And so he's been making art since he could hold a paintbrush, you know. We would go paint and give him space to paint, and that's what he would do. So it's just really kind of the family tradition at this point.
Nice one. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Liberty Du, Faith 47. Her murals are in over 50 countries around the world. She's had exhibitions in New York, Miami, London, Johannesburg. She is our native sister from this land, but now is exploring the world, as she should, with her pen, her paper, her walls, and everything else. We thank you so much for this time, my lady. Really appreciate you. And shout out to Hennessy for the collaboration. Thank you so much.
Thank you, man. You're so awesome. It's been so nice to chat with you.
Bye.
Okay, ciao. Bye-bye.
I'm chatting right now to a guy that I've really known for a long time, but we actually have never spoken in depth.
This is our first time.
His name is Bob the Stylist, and it brings me great pleasure to have him as creatives that we are speaking to right here in honor of the Hennessy Faith 47 bottle. So I always say this, like, it's so important for people to get their flowers. So because of this campaign, we're not giving you your flowers. We're giving you your Kanye. You were on a big Hennessy billboard in Johannesburg.
Yeah.
When did Bob fall in love with not just clothes, but the aesthetic of them and putting them together?
I mean, I'd start with fashion.
Yeah.
How I connected it with fashion. I think I was around 7. Yeah, I used to go through my dad's photo album. And my dad, man, he was like a superstar in his pictures.
Yeah.
But in reality, normal guy. But in his photo albums, man, he was like Mr. Brown. So his alias was amongst his friends. It got to Mr. Brown's like this cool
movie character.
Yeah. And I would see it in Buckenzak and how he dressed up. And it goes back, his brothers. So my mom, I was with my mom last week, and she was telling me about how my dad used to compete with his older brother back in the days. So in Duang, do as a family.
Yes.
And this is, I'm now reflecting, and in hindsight, like, oh, actually, it's been. Mm. Yeah, and Ole Dinalo, she loves fashion, but my dad, because I'm a guy, major key individual who inspired me to pursue, or he contributed towards the love of fashion and fabric, because it's not even just about the aesthetic, the brand, it's the quality. Yes. And that itself is a story, and that reflects the person who's wearing the clothes type of thing.
Yep.
Yeah. And so you'd always strive for quality. You'd always strive to have items that no one has, because in a way you kind of understand who you are. You want, if everyone has it, you won't want that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Fast forward in high school, I'm now popular in Duangu, and I used to dance, right? Moving forward, like, okay, I love fashion, but I couldn't get in. I couldn't get into studying. I couldn't study, right? I couldn't go study further. So I went to retail. This is the closest space to fashion. So that's when I acquired knowledge about putting things together, merchandising. I was a visual merchandiser, customer service. Visual, and that,
visual merchandiser, you'll set up the way the shop looks and the mannequins, right?
Just the mannequins.
Right. Major key.
Fast forward, I left the retail because I felt like I was on the ceiling and I couldn't protrude, right? Did call center for like 3 years, changed everything, right? My contract got terminated. This is now 2010. I ain't going back. This is like a conversation I'm having with myself. I'm not going back. I'm not going to look for a job. I'm going to do this. Yeah, and it's either I'm brave or stupid. Started styling my friends, and I approached my fit. I took style, and I take pictures because I knew I need to have a portfolio.
Yeah.
Right. I did that. It was a mission. I'm out to like pull through and I'll get there. Down Chile is like, Bob, so it ends up tomorrow type of thing. Yeah. But I did that, and blogging became a thing. Luckily, Tumblr was a thing.
Yeah.
So I used to upload the stuff.
What was your blog called?
Boys of Soweto.
Boys of Soweto.
Yeah. So nice. That's how Boys of Soweto came about. And signed a styler, but we felt there's more to a styler, and we wanted to showcase Amata Sekasi, but from a different light. And in that course, I approached Ujodi. Ujodi, she owns a production company, right? Like, yo, man, this is what I want to do. This is what I've been doing. I've been to retail. I've worked in retail. I've worked in a call center environment. I can project myself as a professional human being, right? I can be operating those spaces, but I need knowledge. How do you work the business and whatnot? You know, she gave me that chance, man. I started interning. I worked with Jody, worked on campaigns, crazy, like huge campaigns, whether it be commercials, magazines, so I got exposed to that. We got a gig with Jody for Markham, and we were styling I See a Difference, which were my boys.
I remember that those windows, yeah.
Yeah, and she was like, yo, man, these are your boys, just style them instead of you assisting me. Yeah, and so she gave me that.
Damn, there's been a beautiful divine hand over you, bro. Divinity also can't show itself in the ease.
Through trials, man.
You know, the God comes out through the trials. Because if it was easy, then there would be no space for the divine hand. In terms of you getting the Hennessy deal, how did that happen? And how did you feel about being on a huge-ass billboard in town, bro?
I got a call, man. I was in Slovakia. There was a strange call, like, okay, this is a South African call. And then line, like, yo, man, we've seen your work. We want you to audition. And there's a potential that you could be the face. Like,
yeah.
Okay, cool. Came back.
Slovakia.
So, yeah, East Europe, man.
That's crazy.
Right.
Yeah.
That's just God, man, intervening.
For sure.
Right. Yeah, I went for the auditions, and in March, go to call, like, oh, you're the guy, and yeah, you got the gig.
So how did you feel about it?
As to how I felt and how I feel, still can't put it into words. Yes, it's a great thing. I'm grateful for the opportunity, and it's good for the culture as well.
Yeah, for sure.
Right? Yeah.
I'll tell you why it's good for the culture, bro, because a lot of endorsement deals with big brands go to well-known musicians or even not well-known musicians. So every kid just wants to be a musician because that's the only thing that gets the perks. So when brands like Hennessy start looking at a kaleidoscope of creatives to reward for their dopeness, kids then go, oh, I want to be something else
I can be
instead
that.
Of a DJ or a musician. Representation is something that they speak about all the time. And that's very important. Mm. Yeah, well, I like the point that you made and I just wanted to winabisa.
Yeah.
That jacket you're wearing, it's really, really dope. Where's that from?
This is Suits by Bob the Stylist, man. This is me, man. It's part of the collection. I just dropped it. I dropped the collection in, what, July? And from that, I'm getting gigs and not just in suits, fashion space. Like, yo, let's do uniform for restaurants.
Yes.
For hotels. I'm like, oh, now I'm in a different space.
That's
man.
Dope, my nigga.
It is. It
That's
is, man.
Really, really dope. So what would you define as your style?
Nipuja.
Straight up and Nipuja, down. You ain't seen the shoes. You ain't seen the cuts.
Right. So there's parallel lines in my execution. There's like parallel lines. There's vertical and horizontal lines, and that makes my apparel or the way I execute things become or seen as timeless.
Showcase.
Yeah, and because of the lines that I'm working in, I'm always liking, we're working within lines and it makes it timeless. So you'd say my style is timeless, even though I do retro or futuristic, sure. But it's timeless. Whenever you see it, it's still going to be relevant. I used to be a member for a church called 12 Apostles, and it's quite an old Orthodox church where you're required to attend church 7 days and you have to wear suits. So I started collecting suits, vintage. So that's always been my life. And I was kind of tired of wearing suits the way, like the aesthetic of a suit.
Sure.
And I think I stopped wearing suits, man, as like on an everyday base. I think it was 2017, just stopped. And I was seeking for something fresh.
Gotcha.
And I think with this collection, I found it, which is an infusion of what I'm going through right now. Mm. I'm in a space where I'm now focusing on, I'm contributing my energy to the hip-hop space.
Mm.
So you'll see the aesthetics. There's that hip-hop is being unconventional. It's being who you are, breaking the rules, right? The suit's essentially about that. And at the same time, taking some of the elements from where I come from, Mekas, and we are Soweto. So there were two subcultures, Amapantula and Amabuja. This Buja emerged in 2000. So I kind of was part of that wave.
Yeah.
There's the hip hop, there's this Buja culture, and then there's the sartorial, because that's where the culture comes from, right? The sartorial, the dandy. Mm. Yeah, and so yeah, it's
I love that jacket. I love that it's got the cleanliness of like formal wear, but yet like the rough zip pockets of like, you know what I mean? Of the streets.
No, I'm going to make you one.
Please, bro.
I'm going to make you a two-piece suit. Trust.
Bob,
trust.
Don't play me, dog.
Trust.
Bob, don't play
Kulega.
Nimzwile, bafethu, ne? Nimzwile. And you know me. As soon as I get it, I'm rocking it and I'm posting it. Mar nimzwile. Let me touch on something else that we were talking about before the cameras were set up. And I feel like it's vital for people to hear this. I know I was like pleasantly surprised you're going into music. Oh, you have gone into it.
It's a contribution to the culture.
Yeah, son.
I'm not sure if that's the journey, but I'm opening it up to the universe. Yeah, it's a contribution to the culture. I've taken so much from the hip-hop culture, not just rap, not just from the rap culture, but you know, going back to hip-hop, because cats tend to misdirect people, right? The rap is constituted by certain elements, right? There's the rap element, there's the b-boying, knowledge of self, there's the entrepreneurial part, there's DJing and all of that. So I've taken, because I've been in that space, I'm going to contribute on the rap culture side of things, right? But everything that I do, it's hip-hop, because it's a mindset, it's a philosophy. The knowledge of self, that's what Karis were pushing. So this is going to be my contribution,
nice.
What I've gathered from the culture, from reading, from engaging with people, nice. And I'm going to share with the world.
I want you to really say something to encourage the young people of this country to pursue their dreams.
So I'd say everyone, man, they should work. If you love something or you're passionate about something, I don't know what it is, I'll live for it. Or die for it.
Mm. I mean, Hennessy, you know their history very well.
Yeah.
Collaborating with artists. I still have the Shepherd Fairy box.
Yeah.
And I've kept it for all these years. Crazy enough, Gongo 2020. So shout outs to that divine hand again we were talking about. So
Wow. Faith 47.
Wow.
That's all for you.
Yeah, give thanks.
Thanks, King. And Faith 47 is obviously the calligraphist, graffiti artist who was born, I guess, in Joburg, then moved to Cape Town, then went to overseas. And the bottle's not all.
Oh, yeah?
This, I won't lie, is also a prized possession of everything that they're doing.
And it's not even my birthday yet, bro. My birthday's on the 29th. Ah,
it's your month. Bongetina out yam.
Hey, man. Faith. Watch.
Danke sehr. There you got it. I hope that we did justice to the cause, to the youngins that are going to be watching this. The world is yours, guys. Mm-hmm. For real. Just go get it.
Never stop, never settle.
Broadcast live.